Hi, everybody. Welcome to the Science Salon. Nice to see you all. Another full house. So Sean Carroll was a professor of molecular biology, genetics, and medical genetics at the University of Wisconsin-Madison. He studies evolution of cis regulation in the context of biological development using Drosophila as a model system, which my old day job.
Hey, paid the mortgage.
Yes, yeah. And but now he's the Howard Hughes Medical Institute investigator and director of their science education and filmmaking projects. If most of you students or many of you have probably seen some of his NOVA shows that they've produced, including the beautifully done Your Inner Fish with Neil Shubin. That was a production by Sean. So he's transitioning from the job of being a professional research scientist to also doing science education through the media, television, film, and so on. So before we get into the details of the book, just tell us how you made that transition, why you decided to do that, why that was important.
Well, I think, so I've been an evolutionary biologist for my professional career, and of course there's a lot of interest in both discoveries in evolution and a lot of discussion about the teaching and understanding of evolution. And the more I became involved in those discussions and got involved in writing books or participating in documentaries or things like that, it was clear that there were sort of bigger megaphones to use than just, you know, scientific journals and things like that. So more and more over the years, I got to know a lot more filmmakers, got to know a lot more broadcasters, and understood a little bit of what some of the obstacles were towards, you know, getting, you know, good stories about science out there into the culture. And when Hughes asked me to consider being the head of science education, I realized that would be an opportunity to use Hughes' resources and a big collaborative network of scientists that we have to tell stories about science and scientists on a large scale. So it's a sort of a combination of the prepared mind and the opportunity presenting itself.
Does it work? How do we know that our efforts at popularization of science work?
Well, we don't know a whole heck of a lot. We know a lot about what we do in the classroom. We know a lot about what works in education, and in fact, narrative storytelling is a very powerful educational tool, even if it's underutilized. And so, you know, we also know that minds are, you know, a little more open at ages 14, 16, 18 than they are at 30, 40, and 50.
Hopefully.
And so, yeah, no, they are. And so that's why naturally I gravitated towards the possibility of reaching out to students, people who are, you know, learning about the world and not coming at it yet with a lifetime full of biases. And so, we know enough that, and I think we know a lot from lots of evidence in our culture, that change usually happens from the younger side of the population. So, and there's a lot of students in the audience here today. They're the ones that are going to decide what this world's going to be like and what our democracy is going to be like. And so I thought it'd be a good investment of my time to spend as much energy as I could, both equipping other educators as well as making a lot of original materials that they could use.
So a scientifically literate citizenry we need for the future of our country would be an argument.
Well, I think it's a good argument. I really don't want to run the control, which is, you know, to have a completely scientifically illiterate society, although we have our factions. But no, I think to manage our way into the future, it's quite clear. We need a combination of good science and good management.
Is your sense that the creationists have had less influence, or the role of religion in influencing science education is diminishing since maybe the 80s?
Oh, I think it's certainly diminishing in the last 15 years. I think that intelligent design was one of the last salvos and fortunately worked out well in the courts. And you all could see again in public polls, things like the Pew polls about attitudes about evolution, it's really different between adults 18 to 30 and adults over 65. And just project that out a few decades, a couple more generations, it'll be fairly different than what you and I experienced over the last few decades. I'm not trying to say there's no issue there, that'd be ridiculous. But in terms of traction, in terms of the ability to sway policy on a large scale, I think that, you know, the scientific societies have banded together, educators have banded together to realize, you know, we cannot be, you know, letting science, you know, take second fiddle to, you know, myths. And so we've I think made a lot of progress working collectively. It's just taken a while. There's always going to be setbacks. There's always going to be headlines that are going to upset us. There's going to be court cases. There's going to be all sorts, and it's going to be legislation all the time in various states that will oppose the teaching of evolution. But The legal precedents are on our side, and of course, the facts are on our side.
I'm particularly encouraged by the stats for the number of millennials who check the box for none on religious preference or religious affiliation, 33%. That's a third of Americans born after 1981. Are considered millennials, and I think they're not necessarily atheists, agnostics, skeptics, freethinkers, but they don't have any religious affiliation. So it doesn't really matter what your beliefs are about God, I guess, as long as it doesn't influence public policy or education or something like that.
Well, I think that's right. My own background, I went to a Catholic high school.
You did?
And I was taught evolution straight up, no fine print. I didn't know there was a problem. So for about 60 years, the Catholic education in America has fully taught evolutionary science. So there's a lot of denominations that have long ago made their peace with evolutionary science.
Right.
And I think it's been a pretty productive collaboration and dialogue to bring folks from those communities, to the table, to school boards, to when necessary, even to litigation, to help people understand that there's by no means, monolithic opposition to evolution in the religious community. And it's actually, I think, against our own interests as scientists, to brand this as a science versus religion, writ large argument. It's not, facts on the ground are different. There's a lot of people in the country, citizens as well as denominations, that take their religion seriously and take science seriously. And so I think that's the more likely sort of future settlement, I think, is something that's going to look something like
that. I think Alabama is the last one. There was a county in Alabama that has a sticker. I just tweeted this out the other day because it was put back in. Evolution's only a theory. It's in high school biology. Yeah. I think they're one of the last to do this. So that's encouraging that that's going out because, gravity's only a theory. The atom's only a theory. Germs are only a theory. How come evolution gets picked on?
Yeah, and when that gets challenged on those grounds, they lose. So Cobb County, Georgia did that in the early 2000s, the stickers, and that was struck down by a federal judge. So sometimes these things will happen, and then it's a question, does litigation actually take place to get them struck down again? Because generally, when challenged, science comes out on top. It's just fairly exhausting, to try every possible, case of every school board and every sticker and every sort of renegade, educator.
One of my favorite passages in the second edition of The Origin of Species, Darwin says something like, I see no good reason why any person of faith would be threatened by this theory, because back in Newton and Leibniz's time, people thought, oh, this is going to be a big threat to religion, and it didn't. It's no big deal. But of course, he was being a little optimistic there, I think, in his own time. But maybe, we'll get there to the point where evolution is no different than gravity or any other theory of science.
Well, it's cultural change here in the States. I mean, many countries around the world are already there, right? We just have our own particular history of, the founding of various denominations that were, in fact, probably a rejection against liberal theology, especially things founded in the late 19th century. So America has its own peculiar history there, but you can look around the world at countries that had, deep, deep religious roots that have, accommodated evolution comfortably. So, it's just, I when I say it's a matter of time, that can sound, kind of ridiculously optimistic, but I think over time, evolutionary science and science in general is gaining traction, and the voices of denial are losing. But the battle is never won. I guess that's the battle for civil rights. It's never won.
Right.
You can't go to sleep. You can't go to sleep. But but progress is definitely being made.
Yeah. Speaking of beautiful sentences by Darwin, your book title, Endless Forms Most Beautiful. That's just a great book title. So give us a little bit of background how you came to write this book from those books, the books on Evo Devo and the development of form in life to this.
Sure. So one of the big black box mysteries of biology when I became a scientist, especially by the time I got my PhD, was development. How does a fertilized egg become a complete creature? And when I say black box, it really was that. I mean, it's a spectacular phenomenon. It's a spectacular pageant. If you ever watch it and you remember film clips you might have seen in school, and you just see the egg developing and then organs taking shape and head and tail and all that sort of thing. But we knew nothing of what was going on inside there. And we needed to crack that black box to then have a shot at understanding how the evolution of form takes place. So I joined sort of the world of developmental biology at a critical time when the first genes for making bodies and body patterns were starting to be identified. And rode that into the arena I wanted to go into, which was how do different bodies evolve and different body parts evolve. And so I've now spent almost 30 years studying sort of the making and evolution of the animal kingdom, you know, from a laboratory point of view, understanding how genes work to build body parts and how changes in the way those genes work to build different kinds of bodies and different kinds of body parts. And that's the general field known as evolutionary developmental biology, or evo-devo for short, which is generally concerned with the evolution of form. And the evolution of form is a particularly interesting arena in evolution because that's what's really documented in the fossil record, right? You know, dinosaurs and birds and, you know, hominids and all that. You're looking at the evolution of skeletons and the origin of wings and all this sort of stuff. And we'd like to know where these big transitions took place in the evolution of bodies and in the invention of new kinds of body parts. And so it was a fabulous ride. And I think our first sort of, you know, the most salient discoveries out of that were always seemed to be of keen interest to the public. And I just, yeah, I guess it was probably, you know, time and opportunity again that I wrote my first book, Endless Forms Most Beautiful, about those discoveries of Evo Devo and the discoveries of development that made them possible. And of course I stole Darwin's line from the end, but it really is that question of how have endless forms most beautiful evolved? So Darwin knew they evolved, but didn't know how they evolved. Other than, you know, the general theory of evolution.
One question I was going to ask you toward the end, but it's relevant now, is on this evolution of forms. So Dawkins and I had a little mini debate years ago when I was ranting about alien abductees who always describe the aliens as these bipedal primates with some gnarly stuff on their forehead that speak English with a weird accent. It's like, the likelihood
What's
of this happening
chance?
On some other planet, I mean,
yeah.
It's just virtually zero. Okay,
yeah.
You know, that they're not going to look anything like us, although he made the good point about convergent evolution in Simon Conway Morris's book, Life Solution, which argues that we may be alone in the cosmos because the chances of all these things coming together in the same way on some other planet are so slim, but that kind of form where you have a head on one end and a waste disposal system at the other end and some appendages, or if you're in the water, you have to have kind of a fusiform body because the density of the medium to slip through, or if you're going to fly, you have to have something like wings. So you're going to end up with certain things that just happen over and over and over, and might that not happen on some other planet? And for to get here, you have to have technology, so they have to have something like thumbs, and so they end up looking like what I made fun of. And so I'm just curious to ask people that think about these things, what are the chances of something like that happening?
Well, I mean, I think it's all degrees, and there are, of course, lots of people here in Pasadena that think about the probability of life of any form out there in the universe. I think that if you think about complex life, multicellular life, you know, the idea that it would be bilateral, and then if bilateral have some organization of sort of front and back, I think that's really likely if there's multicellular life. But multicellular life, you know, had a long history on Earth before anything like us, you know, came around. So then you have to go to that question of, well, what's the probability that something, I mean, my God, you're really going to go for bipedal? You kind of keep going down the probability spectrum. But I think, you know, if life is common in the universe, then I think multicellular life will be fairly common in the universe. And if there's multicellular life, then there's probably, you know, bilaterally symmetric and somewhat sizable creatures of some sort. And
well, remember when Dale Russell did that diagram of the bipedal dinosaur carrying a spear around with, you know, a big head? And
yeah.
I mean, so that's rerunning the tape here.
Yeah.
And we don't exist, but dinosaurs don't go extinct, and boom.
Yeah. I'm not buying it, but
okay. Yeah.
Yeah. No, I think, you know, we're occupying a very, very slim moment, you know, in the history of the universe. And maybe that's all we're going to have as a moment if we don't.
So maybe we better not go extinct.
Yeah,
we probably shouldn't go extinct. Okay,
yeah.
That's a good idea.
It's a good idea.
I mean, if you think about it for a second, you know, Neanderthals got all the way up to brains the size of ours, with obviously have different modules in their brains and so on, and hands, and maybe some kind of crude language, stone tools, all the way up to 30,000 years ago. And they went extinct. I mean, had we gone extinct instead of them, they still may be in caves. I mean, there was not a lot of sign of progress. I don't know.
I think it's for Neanderthals. I would look at it this way. I think for Neanderthals, it was just a matter of time, right? I mean, give them a little more time. I mean, we're, you know, civilization's only about 10 or 12,000 years old.
Right.
So, yeah, if we didn't come along, if we didn't sort of push them out, you know, of Europe, maybe it'd be all Neanderthal. But I'm, you know, they did have a fairly sophisticated brains. They did have a lot of social behavior. I don't put a big distance between ourselves, Homo sapiens, and Neanderthals. in terms of capability. It's just time. We've had 30,000 more years than Neanderthals to you know, evolve our culture and all the things that we sort of do. So I have a very high opinion of Neanderthals.
Well, this brings me to Robert Wright's book, Non-Zero. He speculates about this. So if it wasn't us, Neanderthals, if not Neanderthals, maybe Homo erectus, if not them, maybe chimps or gorillas, just give them maybe another million years it takes, something like that. But so that's the question of, back to where this book is going, with certain principles of physics and biology that exist because of the kind of planet we live on and so on. There's a certain inevitability, not a pull like a direction, but just an inevitability, the way things are likely to unfold.
Yeah, so I mean, I agree with that. I think when you, always thinking about us, you know, I'm, you know, the idea that some fairly impressive creatures would be around, you know, if things had been gone differently in the last couple million years. Yeah, I'm with that. My wife and I always tease her. I said, you know, 10 or 20,000 more years of dog breeding, they're going to talk back. You know? Even a yellow lab, you know?
How about a chocolate lab?
Might actually talk back, yeah. So, so I think some of this is a matter of time, but you know, our path is so peculiar and so particular that I don't think we have to, you know, on the one hand, you know, I certainly don't believe that it was inevitable.
Right.
And but on the other, I do recognize that it's pretty special.
Yeah. So let's get into the Serengeti rules. The rules are principles of physiology and biology and physics and so on, having to do with food capture or maybe energy capture from cells inside our body to whole ecosystem. So what led you to sort of put those two together into one package?
Well, I'm going to try to break this into a couple parts because it's a bit of a mouthful. But, you know, I think especially for biology, which, you know, doesn't have a lot of laws, let's put it that way. You know, there are things that are invariant wherever you are, biologists are trying to figure out how life works. And the more you can find generalities, the better. So you're confronted when you look at biology with particulars everywhere. In fact, one of my favorite quotes from a biologist is, you know, it's an infinitude of particulars. They have to be sorted out case by case. If that's the case, we're doomed, okay, because there's just too many species and too many specific cases. So it's always a quest to find the general rules. In my own field of evo-devo, we found a few general rules about, for example, how form evolves. So the particular case of, you know, how the butterfly got its spots or humans got big brains, the specific evolutionary stories are different. But in general, we know what's going on. We know that what parts of the genome are evolving that give physical changes. And that wasn't understood before. So, you know, you get glimpses of light and generalities. In this case, what prompted really the writing of this book was complete ignorance on my part of ecology. So I understand a fair amount about life at the cellular and molecular and sort of, you know, organ level and how a creature functions and is built. But I went to the Serengeti a year and a half ago or so, and I went for a lot of reasons that may come out in the course of this conversation. But no matter what I'd seen on television or read or anything like that, I was awestruck. I was surprised that I was awestruck. I was like, okay, I go with my family. There's six of us in the vehicle. You know, I'm going to be Mr. Cool. I'm going to be Mr. You know, the Mr. You know, answer, right? I'm going to give them an answer to any question they have. Dad, how does this work? I don't know. Okay? You know, there's a million wildebeest. There's 5,000 topi. They're about the same size. Why is that? I don't know. So
good for you.
Yeah. So, and what I was awestruck by was just the numbers. I mean, there's magnificent places in this world, and like I've gone to Yellowstone a lot, and you know, always made the extra effort to see the wildlife, et cetera. But come on, 20,000 giraffes in the Serengeti. I mean, that's kind of ridiculous, right? It's such
staggering
abundance. It is staggering, and I didn't understand how it worked, and I didn't know if we knew how it worked. So I came back and I started poking into the science literature, and then finding some pioneers that had been out there for decades trying to figure out how it worked. And when I started reading about what they had learned about how it worked, I thought, wow, this is kind of like the way we do stuff in test tubes, you know? logically, kind of similar to that. And some of the surprises were the same, that there's these really individual species have certain individual species have much bigger effect on everything else than some others do. And we kind of see that in the molecular world, that there's sort of big guns in the molecular world that sort of, you know, tell other genes what to do. And so the ecologist to me seemed on a pretty similar, if entirely independent and parallel journey to what molecular biology has been on. And I thought, well, you know, there might be a story in there somewhere, and you'll all be the judge of that. But it's the Serengeti rules. I picked the Serengeti just as it's sort of the
romantic.
it's a romantic somewhat description. But look, it's also our homeland. You're talking about homo sapiens. Is where our ancestors evolved in this kind of system.
Right.
These large mammals around, and you know the butchery marks are there at Olduvai Gorge, right? I mean, I could have called this the Lake Erie Rules because they operate there too, but I think that from a marketing point of view, not quite the same punch, not quite the same romance as the Serengeti. But in all honesty, I try to pay it off in the book to go back to the Serengeti and explain, okay, what were we seeing? How do these things, these basic rules were actually discovered elsewhere in tide pools or in coastal systems or in fact in Midwestern lakes. But how do these general rules play out with those storybook animals that you know all of us grew up with? Out on the Serengeti, and the Serengeti really as the last sort of great, you know, enormous wilderness with you know Pleistocene megafauna roaming around it, and the site of the last great migration. It's also sort of a symbol of something else, which is something that I don't think we can afford to lose. I mean, if you lose the Serengeti,
right.
You know, our world. Thinking now, you think about the whole arc of our evolutionary trajectory.
Yeah.
I think that gives us the F finally gets written in our report card, right? If we blow out the last great place where the great herds roam. So, as a biologist, I think it's kind of like our Hippocratic Oath that we have to be paying attention to the health of the biosphere, not just in the pretty places, but in the places we need the biosphere to work, you know, functionally.
So. I think that wasn't even really introduced into college courses until when we were undergraduates, maybe in the 70s or so. It became a field to study, ecology. There's courses, textbooks, and so on. Before that, it was the individuals you cover here just doing primary research.
That's right, yeah. I mean, really sort of an outgrowth of natural history, and it was more observational. And one of the heroes in the book is an ecologist who does one of the most important experiments in the history of ecology. And that experiment entailed driving out to the Pacific coast. He was a young professor at Seattle, his name's Bob Payne, drove out to the Pacific coast every month, took a crowbar out of his car, marched out to the rocks, pried the starfish off a certain patch of rocks, threw them out in the ocean, measured what was going on the rocks, drove back. A month later, comes back, pries those starfish off, throws out in the ocean. What he was doing was he was testing the influence of a predator on an ecosystem. And in this case, the starfish is the predator. It feeds on mussels and barnacles and things like that. And it really wasn't known what would happen if a system didn't have an apex predator. And he saw dramatic effects in a matter of months and learned that the entire community collapsed in the absence of this starfish.
Apex predator.
Yeah, so a cheap but brilliantly important experiment.
So there's a way of doing a controlled experiment, but you can't exactly do that in the Serengeti, right? So you wait for natural events, political events, or natural disasters, or something?
It's a little harder. I got to give credit to some of the ecologists who have found ways to do experiments. But what happened in the Serengeti, I didn't know this story, and you may not either. So really, I mean, the Serengeti, after, you know, up to through World War II, people were not, you know, traveling around parts of the world as ecotourists, right? So the Serengeti was not well known at all in the 1950s when biologists first started arriving there. And the first, you know, compulsion they had was, let's count all the animals. And that first survey of the Serengeti, which revealed 350,000 plus large animals, the biologists were really concerned, is there really enough food, enough water, enough plains, enough space for 350,000 animals? Well, little did they know that for about 70 years, the Serengeti was getting hit with these outbreaks of a virus called rinderpest that was devastating wildebeest and buffalo. And that it turns out that was coming in from cattle, and a vaccine for the cattle had been developed in the early 1960s. And once the cattle vaccination program happened, the numbers of wildebeest and buffalo in the Serengeti just started exploding right in front of the biologist's eyes. So that by the late 1970s, that 350,000 animals had turned into almost 2 million. And so, yeah, there was enough food and enough space for that many animals in the 50s. In fact, there was room for a lot more animals. So that was not a very deliberate experiment on the part of humans, but in this case, when you track the effect of what does it happen by when you suppress the wildebeest and buffalo population, well, you see what happens when you move that suppression, it changed the Serengeti dramatically. And now you have wildebeest, a million lawnmowers, you know, just mowing their way through 600 miles of the Serengeti, and they cut the grass much lower. That creates habitat for butterflies and things like that. There's a lot less fire in the Serengeti, a lot less intense fire. That allows more trees to grow. The trees grow. That provides cover for predators. It also provides food for the giraffes. So lo and behold, if you take away the virus that's affecting the wildebeest, you wind up with more giraffes. And you got to figure that out, which took about 30 years, you got to figure out that whole chain of events. It's not something that any biologist would walk in and say, well, let's make that wildebeest vaccine so that we have more giraffes
right,
here. I mean,
right.
Nobody would have that, would understand that connection at all. But that's the sort of thing the ecologists were figuring out, was that these connections, these sort of chain reactions through ecosystems that they needed to understand to be able to predict how the system would respond. So even if it's not a very controlled experiment, it's nonetheless, I think, a really valid.
You can infer causality.
That's right.
So it's really, you're really talking about food capture or energy capture, maybe.
Well, there's two schools of thought about this in the ecological world. You can look at food chains from an energy point of view, but ecological interactions, I mean, if you just told me the number of calories that were being exchanged there, you know, that's a good physicist's view of biology. But really, the ecological interactions that are surprising and that were totally not only not understood but even not believed was how different parts of the food chain related to each other. So it was really thought, sort of the energy-centric view, that you know plants get their energy from the sun and they provide the food that then the herbivores graze on, and then you know if there's enough herbivores around, there's some food for the carnivores. And the thought was that everything was being driven from the bottom up.
Right.
But what Bob Payne's work did, and some work that he inspired by some other folks shortly thereafter, was to show that, in fact, the carnivores were having top-down effects. And the carnivores were controlling herbivores in a way that allowed the foliage to grow. This is most dramatic, say, for example, in the Pacific coast, where sea otters control the populations of sea urchins, which would otherwise denude the kelp. And the kelp forest is dependent upon the presence of sea otters to control the sea urchins. Nobody was having these thoughts through the 1960s. And it was pioneers that I talk about in the book, Bob Payne, Jim Estes, that discovered these really strong indirect connections between things like carnivores and plants that turned people's thinking of how the world worked upside down. And so it's, you know, I the reason why I'm reacting to sort of the energy thing is I think that it's easier for everyone generally outside of biology to jump in and say, wait, let's talk about the creatures. Let's talk about the landscape.
Yeah.
Let's talk about what you'd actually see when something is present in a system, when something's not present in the system. And it's really about those interactions. And what goes on when we manipulate these systems, we fish or farm or whatever it might be, is that we're affecting the interactions that are available. So you can describe that quantitatively as in energy, but you can also appreciate it better in terms of just the regulation of the numbers of things, the numbers of trees, the amount of kelp forests, the number of urchins, whatever it might be.
We have a mountain lion living in Griffith Park. P22, he's tagged, they're all tagged.
I just, parenthetically,
he's just in the news yesterday, he ate one of the koala bears at the zoo. So, it's, okay, now
that's
what do we do?
That's not a food chain.
Yeah.
that's a little artificial food chain there. You ate a koala bear
at
the zoo.
So now what? You know, because they want to, these mountain lions are beautiful, but of course they're predators.
Well, this is what's gone on across the world, and if I can represent a little bit some of the ecologists that I've met in the last 2 years, is that, you know, the story is that these predators have generally not been welcome wherever humans have been, whether that's wolves or mountain lions or even coyotes or certainly in the ocean, sharks or spiders in our backyard, snakes, we want to get rid of them. But if they have a big influence on the structure of those communities, we're doing that at our own peril.
I love the story you told about the wolves in Yellowstone.
Yeah.
And there was a video out about a year ago, showing the influence of the apex predator, the wolf. I don't know if that was one of your productions, but it's a great story. Where they were, well, they were hunted, I guess, initially, and then reintroduced decades later, and everything changed. Maybe.
Yeah. So the clues were, so in Yellowstone, and this is true across most of North America, the wolves were exterminated from Yellowstone in the 1920s, and by humans. So they were definitely persecuted. It was deliberate extermination of the wolves, and of course, you know, for anyone who was, you know, raising animals in the West, ranchers and things like that, wolves were, you know, perceived as an enemy because there were certainly stock losses if you had wolves around. But biologists noticed by the 1990s, as they looked across Yellowstone, that, for example, there had been very little new aspen growth in 70 years.
Oh, right. They did the tree ring cores.
They did the tree rings. So the aspen are all really old. They're actually kind of senescent. Why is that? And you look at pictures of Yellowstone from the 1920s versus, say, the 1990s, and the landscape is quite different. Why is that? Well, no one was sure what was really going to happen, but in 1995, the first wolves were reintroduced back to Yellowstone. And within a few years, some biologists started to notice some things were really different. Elk behavior was different, but also elk numbers started to decline as the wolf packs built up. And then you start seeing things like along the riverbanks, you're seeing cottonwood and willow grow. Now you're seeing aspen start to proliferate. See, in the areas where the willow are growing, it's better habitat for beavers. So you're seeing beaver colonies come back. And what happened was that over those 70 years, because the elk population had no constraint, they were just browsing down the young aspen and other trees. And when they browse along the river's edge, that takes away the trees that hold the soils there. So actually the riverbanks were eroding. So this was changing the course of rivers through Yellowstone, that the riverbanks were eroding in. Now the trees are growing back, and it's a really dramatic effect. So again, you know, if you say, you know, just sort of think of it as a recipe, you know, add wolves, trees grow. You want to work that one out for me, kids? You know? So that's the sort of, you know, and that to me was what was really exciting about, you know, finally learning ecology, was that these discoveries have been made about the regulation of, you know, the numbers of things in the biosphere. And that the regulation worked in, you know, really surprising ways. And ways, not to get into any details that are important today, but I had those same sort of experiences working in the laboratory of trying to work out regulatory mechanisms in about genes and things like that. That if you don't know all the links in a chain, so if there's five or six links in a chain, and you think that this does that, which does that, which does that, and you don't know about one of those links, you're going to have something really wrong, and you're not going to know how to intervene.
Which that's is why taking medications is always problematic.
That's right. So hopefully, you know, the more we know about how the human body works, the more we know about these regulatory chains in our own bodies, the more targeted and the more effective our medicines can be, with fewer side effects, hopefully. The example I talked about in the book are statins. Statins were discovered, and their whole rationale really comes out of understanding the surprising logic of how cholesterol is regulated in the human body. Pioneering work that was done by Mike Brown and Joe Goldstein in the 1970s. And statins have dramatically changed cardiology. I've had cardiologists tell me that they've retired early because of statins. they don't do the surgeries they used to do.
Wait, I thought they wanted to keep us sick to make money, and it was part of big pharma.
Well, you see, that if you're the surgeons and pharma are in competition.
I see.
Pharma
yes,
would like
right.
to give you statins. Surgeons would like to cut you open. And so far, it looks like statins have been gaining some ground there. Yeah.
And then let's talk about cancer for a minute, because in a way, it's the same sort of thing. You're trying to starve the cancers, or you know, maybe some technique other than radiate them and cut them out, but maybe there's an internal ecological change we can make.
Well, it took a long time to figure out that, in fact, cancer was really generally due to broken genes. It wasn't really even clear for a while that cancer was a genetic disease. And I talk about some of the pioneers involved in that in the book. But once you know that there are specific changes in the cells that make cells grow out of control, then you're thinking, well, how can I specifically target those cells and not kill all the other dividing cells in the body? And the story I tell, the sort of pioneer drug in this class, is something called Gleevec, which was invented for the treatment of a type of leukemia that is due to a particular type of chromosome break in a specific gene. And that was, you know, an amazing drug that changed the fates of, you know, tens of thousands of people very quickly. But another example, understand the players. I'd sort of use a sports metaphor. This is what biologists do, whether it's inside our bodies or out on the plane. Understand the players, understand the rules that govern their play, and then if something's wrong, you know, figure out, you know, either how to restore those links or, you know, repair the injured player, as the case may be. And that's where medicine is at today, and that's really where management of ecosystems could and in some places is at.
I first encountered this problem when my mother got meningioma brain tumors, and they cut the main one out, and then two more grew. And then they cut those out, and then four more grew. And then I encountered the work of Judah Faulkner at Harvard Medical School, who was a surgeon, and he noticed when he cut out tumors, they were very bloody.
That's right.
Engorged with blood vessels. And he was really the first to ask, why are blood vessels growing into tumors? I mean, they must be secreting something to draw the blood vessels to grow into them. So we call those angiogenesis chemicals, right. And then in search for anti-angiogenesis to block the tumors from secreting these, to essentially starve them to death.
Right.
But then, back to my mom's case, the tumors themselves also secrete anti-angiogenesis chemicals, so other tumors can't compete with them. So it's sort of a Darwinian competition inside the body between tumors. So it's almost like you take out Saddam Hussein and you get two really bad dictators and then four of them. And then, anyway.
It's the first analogy yes. I've heard like that, but yeah. Okay. Yeah.
So it's kind of a political cancer. Yeah. But I get, apparently the search for these anti, it's very more complicated than he thought it would be.
Right. But the general idea is if you have too little insulin, we provide insulin, right? If you have too much inflammation, we provide something that pushes the other way. This goes all the way back. There's a fellow I talk about in the book, Walter Cannon, who came up with the idea of homeostasis. And the idea is most of the time what we hope for is that, you know, our lives are pretty stable inside, right? We notice little changes, right? We notice when we have a fever of half a degree, right? No, I don't feel well. I'm a little bit under the weather, et cetera. So most of the time, amazingly, there's about 20,000 chemicals in your body, they're being maintained in particular ranges. Some are really abundant and some are really, really scarce, but they're being maintained in those ranges. And when they get a little bit outside that range, we might feel it, disease might be manifest, and they get very far out of that range, it of course can be fatal. And Cannon sort of redefined the role of the physician was to sort of help the body push things back into range. That's what the tools that the physician had available was to try to get the body to sort of start regulating itself again. And a lot of, certainly 80 years of pharmaceuticals are pretty much geared towards that.
But I mean, but the moment you take something to tweak one of the, then you got the 20 others that are, ranges change a little bit. Then you got to take something for that.
You can be chasing a lot of things.
Yeah.
That's right.
That's right.
But, if you look back over history and say, well, how sharp were our chemical instruments, 40 years ago? Not so great. They get sharper by the decade. And when we start to learn how to manage certain diseases, you get fifth generation, sixth generation, seventh generation drugs. They do have to perform a little bit better, either on efficacy or safety than previous generations. So it's it takes a long time to manage a disease. But that's the path that we've been on, and we've made it a huge priority, obviously, as a society, to have better and better medicines all the time.
This is my explanation for how homeopathy works, because it does nothing, and the moment the body starts to get better, whatever you did last gets the credit. So
there you go.
Sometimes it's better to do nothing, and that's what homeopathy is really good at.
That's right.
Yeah. So maybe the long-term hope, say half a century to a century for cancer, would be instead of radiating, cutting, and chemical treatments, just to tweak the body, tweak the genome, or I don't know, epigenetics.
Here's what's happening. I think so. Where we are right now today, and Gleevec was the pioneer in this, is that we've got about three dozen drugs right now that are targeting mutations that exist in certain subsets of tumors. So the best management, if it can't be because surgery is ideal. If the tumor is a solid tumor and you can get it at all, that's the best.
Yeah.
But once you have to deal with something that may be spreading through the body, you're going to have to use chemistry to try to get it under control. And there's about 140, so there's 20,000 genes basically in our genome. About 140 of those have been implicated in one way or another in cancer. Usually somewhere between about two to eight of them are altered in an individual human cancer. So the way cancer can be managed and is being managed in many cases today is to try to genetically profile an individual's cancer. And if you get cancer and I get cancer, even in the same tissue, we're going to have different genetic profiles. So you want your oncologist to know what you've got. I want my oncologist to know what I've got so that the right cocktail can be delivered. And this didn't exist 15 years ago, right? So three dozen approved drugs now, many more in the pipeline. I know that just sounds incredibly optimistic. I'm not trying to say that cancer is not incredibly scary and it's gonna affect every one of us and people in our family, but this is where the battle's at right now. And the battle is won first for knowledge, to understand there's about 140 genes. They play heavy regulatory roles in the way cells behave. We can ignore about 19,800 other genes. They're not directly involved in the cancer. Zero in on them, profile the cancer, target it, and we got a fighting chance. And this is why some people are having some great outcomes that weren't possible before.
Detection devices for early detection of cancer.
All right.
Yeah, my wife and I went and saw Michio Kaku the other night. He was talking about the future of medicine and, well, all kinds of science. But one of them was a device is in your toilet and you pee, and it says, oh, you're going to have breast cancer in 10 years. I guess because you have just a few cells that secrete just a tiny bit, and that's detectable, and therefore you can do something now. To prevent it from growing.
Yeah, I think all these early warning systems that we can develop, the same thing is going to go on for Alzheimer's, right? So here you're looking at probably the biggest public health challenge that we're facing. Okay, so 5 million Americans today, but that number's
because of us baby boomers.
That's right.
Hitting the
wall.
That's
right. But only recently we had the ability to image. And from of what's going on in the brain. So Alzheimer's, it looks like the trigger to Alzheimer's is the buildup of something called amyloid plaque, a lot like the sort of analogous anyway to the plaques that give us heart disease. And that's now can be imaged, and we're understanding that those plaques are forming years before there's any kind of symptoms, which may be the therapeutic window.
Right. Right?
To get in there and try to, just as we've done with heart disease, prevent the formation of those plaques.
What are some early signs? Like, I have a hard time remembering actors' names. This isn't one of the...
And we're going to scare the hell out of each other in the next 5 minutes because I have all the same... Actually, here I was in L.A. trying to remember names yesterday. But, sorting out the warning signs of something that's, you know, a disease state versus aging.
Yeah.
And for you, that's just a matter of you're just putting too much new knowledge in. So just displacing
Thank
too much
you.
Other stuff. So you don't have time for that kind of trivia of actors' names. Why are you worrying about that? There are memory loss, short-term memory loss, you know, forgetting where you put things. I mean, people start to notice, and certainly your loved ones start to notice if there's something really markedly out of the way. And there's good information on this from certainly, you know, Alzheimer's associations and things like that. But it's affecting, you know, so many families, and it's such an important societal burden in terms of caregiving and our institutions, nursing homes, things.
This
like
is one
that.
Of the films you're working on now.
Mentioned.
So what are there any cutting edge experimental drugs on the market or not on the market?
Not on the market, but on that is there something I'll go out, stick my neck out and say promising? Because it makes a lot of sense.
Yeah.
I look for really, you know, rational drug design. If you know what's wrong, you got a shot at fixing it. At least a chance at lessening the severity or the rate of decline. And in this case, in the Alzheimer's case, so we co-produced a film that's going to be on Nova April 13th called Can Alzheimer's Be Stopped? And we had inside access to clinical trials for, it's a similar type of drug being developed at several companies, little different tweaks between the different companies, to try to remove those plaques that are forming in our brains or prevent them from even being laid down in the first place. And the clinical trials that have been done, they're promising. You know, we're not at approval yet because large-scale trials are underway right now. But the imaging data says those drugs do remove the plaque. And if we've got it figured out that that's the player that triggers Alzheimer's, then removing that plaque or preventing it from ever forming would make a lot of sense. So, and it looks to me a lot like other diseases in terms of where we are in terms of combating it, in that, you know, you got to make that first step. You get a little traction against it, then you get the second-generation treatment,
right.
You get the third-generation treatment. But we've not yet had anything that could slow the progression of Alzheimer's at the root cause. And I'm reasonably optimistic that we'll have something. Now, for people that are already well advanced, most of the clinical data would say, unfortunately, that we probably cannot pull them back from where they are. But for people with mild to moderate disease or who have not developed disease at all yet, I think there's going to be a window.
We like to track the techno-optimists, like the singulitarians. You know, they claim, like Ray Kurzweil, if you can make it to 2030, you get to live forever. which I'm fond of saying, boy, if I die in 2029, I'm going to be so pissed if they make it. You know, eternity, and I missed it. I'm the last generation to die.
That's a great point.
But the argument is based on these, exponential growth curves of mostly computer technology. I do wonder, does it apply to medical inventions and technologies and medicines?
Well, you know, we're still, I mean, the average, I mean, there's been a, in the last century, there's been a dramatic increase in you know, average in lifespan, yep. life expectancy, and a reduction in infant mortality.
But not the upper ceiling of 120.
The upper ceiling about 110, whatever that might be. No, we're not blowing past that. So at some point, the machinery, something takes us out.
Okay, so. Why? Why does that happen in terms of the rules? Why does the whole system start to just fall apart?
Well, you know, it's not like it just
why do we die?
All of a sudden. Why do we die? Yeah. Is that real? God, you're gonna, you guys are tough.
Yeah. Yeah. We want the big answers.
Come on, answer, man. Hey, I was stumped by a million wildebeest, and now you want to know why we die. Well, you know, the evolutionary view, I think, is the right one. If you look at disease incidence, if you look, for example, at cancer incidence in people, as soon as they've passed their reproductive prime in the early 40s, it just rises exponentially. And I think that's basically saying that, you know, natural selection works to weed out the mutations that give us a disease, a predisposition to disease early, but it doesn't weed out the stuff that affects us later, like senescence.
Right.
So, you know, natural selection, the way our biology only works, we really, really care about getting our genes in the next generation and not, living to 200 is not a priority.
I was thinking about this reading your book, the systems approach that most anti-aging people talk about. Well, just fix this one thing here, take the statins for plaque, or maybe there's a dozen things that take you out, so you take 240 supplements a day like Ray Kurzweil. But after reading this, I'm thinking it's just every system, every cell, the whole thing is just disintegrating, or sort of entropy, the second law is just taking effect.
We're kind of running down in those last decades, that's right. And, will we find some way to extend something? I mean, I think the reason to look at something like Alzheimer's and dementia is that it's about quality of life to the end as well. I think nothing can be more tragic and heartrending than, for people that, what if you talk about humanity, what characterizes our memories, our way we relate to each other. So to lose that in the last years of life, that is really tragic.
So you want to be like a car battery that goes boom instead of
well, let's take a vote. let's take a vote. I think or eaten by a croc or something like that. That'd be kind of a nice way to go.
On the Serengeti.
Yeah, for a few seconds. But
what about telomeres and changing the genome?
Well, cellular aging, but can we do that in a systematic way? Well,
I don't know.
You probably can have some people here who could speak to that better than I can. I'm never going to say not possible because, the history of crystal ball gazing in science is really terrible.
Yes.
And fortunately, the error has generally been we've been too conservative about what's been possible.
Right.
So I think the combination of our imagination, individual and collective imagination has been pretty phenomenal. I do think I don't want to get anyone's hopes up. I would like to live whatever decades I have left with, some
full capacity. Some
amount of capacity to remember, Tom Petty's lyrics and my kids' names, a couple of basics like that.
Which one is that again? No.
Yeah.
So before we turn it over for questions, let's kind of reflect on the sort of the environment and 7 billion humans, we're going to hit 9-10 billion by 2050. Hopefully it'll start to go down. But with like treating different parts of the body, there's so many different systems. Once you go into the Serengeti or whatever, and you put the wolves in, and then it has this change, and then you got to put another species in, can we restore? What would be a naturally balanced ecosystem that has humans involved?
Well, we could talk if we go place by place. We could be here all day and all night. But I think what we're basically saying is if we understand how these places work, if we know who some of the key players are, if we monitor those things, we have a better chance of managing them. And I'm just going to pick one thing that is actively managed and is really important, and there's a good track record for it, and that's our fisheries. So in the U.S., particularly over the last 20 or so, 25 years, we've taken the management of fish stocks really seriously. The motivation is pretty simple. It's economic for people who are in that industry, and it's our food security, right? So the ocean is a fish-eat-fish world, right? So Serengeti is tame compared to the oceans, right? Just a whole lot of eating going on, one thing or the other. A lot of apex predators that are very tasty. Tuna, cod, right? We love the apex predators. We tend to fish them. With, of course, a lot of cascading effects on other fish populations because they are the apex predators. So, we've realized that we can't fish in a completely, arbitrarily, we can't just fish in any way we feel like. If we want these fish stocks to be around, we have to fish in a more self-regulated way.
No tragedy, the commons.
That's right. And the good news, I would say. I know you're going to think, what is this guy? He's so optimistic. All I hear about are terrible headlines, and he comes in smiling. We're going to look at cancer, Alzheimer's, environmental destruction. But honestly, I would not have written the book if I did not think that there was good enough evidence that we know enough and that there's good case studies out there of good management. We just hear all the horror cases, you know, Flint, Michigan, right? I
mean, right.
Wow, you know, a poster child. So those always get a huge amount of attention. And the fact that, you know, this is through NOAA and the fisheries management that, you know, maybe 45 to 50 stocks have been declared depleted at various times in the last 2.5 decades. And about 30 of those have been rebuilt. And the key to that, and that's something I want people to take home, especially from the book or anything I might say, something I sort of learned, is that nature is incredibly resilient. Now let me define that, not in some kind of, you know,
New agey
sort of BS way. Here's what I mean. If the habitat's there, if the resources are there, it's amazing how productive nature can be. So when the Georges Bank, for example, off in the Northeast Atlantic was closed because of overfishing in the 90s, several species came roaring back within 3 to 5 years because, you know, a little bit of protection and
right.
All those stocks are growing up. If you look at the species that we've protected are kind of, you know, more famous than, you know, yellow flounder or something like that. Manatees in Florida, now they've grown fivefold since they were protected 40 years ago.
Right.
They were proposed to be delisted this spring from the endangered species list. Go back to sea otters, which I was talking about. They're really important. Well, the fur trade, by the turn of the last century, around 1900, had almost exterminated sea otters. They were down to about 1,000 individuals along the entire Pacific coast all the way over to Japan. They, by the 70s, they roared back to 100,000 plus animals.
Wow.
Elephant seals, down to 20.
Wow.
Up to 200,000.
Wow.
So that resilience is there, given a chance. And generally what that chance means is habitat plus lack of human person. It doesn't mean zero. It just means, in fact, in the fisheries, it often means, you know, a sustainable level of catch, not excessive level of catch. So.
And sex, lots of sex.
Lots of sex. Darwin would appreciate this
yeah.
immensely. The ability of nature to reproduce, to produce massive amounts of young. And when we're not increasing the mortality of those young by taking them, the populations can really rebound.
I like the story about scallops on the East Coast that were then eaten by all the rays, and the scallop population collapses because the rays weren't being eaten by the sharks, because the sharks were what, hunted?
Well, the sharks are being decimated in the world's oceans. So the sharks are getting annihilated for two reasons. Shark finning for the supermarket. And as bycatch, because of the way industrial fishing is being done, just lots and lots of sharks get caught. So you have things like hammerheads that are on, you know, they're highly endangered. You know, there's several species of hammerheads that are highly endangered. So shark populations have really crashed since World War II. Now, they've been the apex predators in the oceans for 400 million years. Okay?
Wow.
So taking out sharks is not
a
good plan for the oceans.
Right.
And what showed up, what made people go, wait a second, what's going on here, was that what happens is shark prey then increase in numbers. And the overpopulation of those prey can mean that other things like shellfish get pounded, and no scallops for us.
Does the UN?
And that's really the whole thing. We
yes.
paid attention when
yes.
no scallops for us.
Yes.
So now we've got a crisis, right?
So we did something about it. But does the UN not have enough teeth to get other countries to go along with
this? This is the tough part in the world. So our local waters, you know, we've got agencies that take care of, and fortunately, you know, there's a lot of ocean that the U.S. is responsible for. So that's sort of the good news. But if you look in international waters, you know, there's a lot of pirate fishing going on. There's a lot of underreporting of what gets taken. Places like the Mediterranean, 96% of stocks in the Mediterranean are officially depleted, and there's concern that some are beyond the point of
the EU return. Doesn't have enough.
28
power.
Countries talking, but
they're just talking.
This is they've had a lot of trouble sort of, you know, initiating policies or actually, you know, exerting regulation that all countries will abide by, because the economic impact is different between the different fishing countries, and you're going to have, you know, fishing villages that are with major restrictions. They're going to have big economic problems, and that's
right.
of course political problems.
Right.
So it's a lot easier for us as one country, despite how weird we are, especially now, that, you know, we have one agency and one country regulating a lot of ocean on, you know, the
right.
Atlantic and Pacific coast. And the Mediterranean has just got a whole lot of
yep.
different countries represented around the table. And the problem is every year that they don't pull it together, it's really, you know, it's gotten worse and worse. Like in 2007 or 2008, when they first passed these regulations, they just had an emergency meeting in February saying, you know, we're in dire straits now. It's you know, they may have to just go to really extreme measures to stop the further erosion of fish stocks, because there is a point where they're gone.
Yeah.
And then
your economy that depends on it is collapsed.
No fish for anybody.
Yeah, yeah.
And the numbers vary, but I've read from certain sources, you know, about a third of the people in the world get the majority of their protein from the ocean.
Right.
So we should be paying attention.
Right. Yeah. So let's go to your questions here. We had thank you.
Thank you.
Right here, I think a student. Yeah, go ahead. Speak up.
Do you think that veganism would help to replenish the...
Veganism, would that help?
Yeah, I think, you know, to some degree. You know, we have to look at how we're handling croplands too, right? And there are issues there we have to handle. But I think somebody presented this to me not too long ago, the idea of reducitarianism.
Yes.
That would be the other one, which is just a little less,
you
know...
less guiltful.
Yes, eating less of those things that are, you know, put a higher stress on our systems. Now, look, and I think, you know, it's great. We should practice what we preach, right? And, you know, look at the guy you're talking to, body by McDonald's, right? Okay, so I'm doing a little better in the last couple of years. Ever since I went to the Serengeti, there's more, you know, black bean burgers on my menu. But so I think there's things we got to do at home, but I think we also have to export some know-how around the world. There's the knowledge base and the sort of regulatory structures around the world are really, really patchy, and we should be helping others manage their own resources better. And I don't mean in a kind of, you know, imperialistic, we know better sort of way. I mean really in an altruistic sort of way, whether that's, you know, a scientific Peace Corps or whatever you want to think about. Because, you know, you look around the world and a lot of places, you know, they would like to be in a better shape, but they just don't have the combination of institutions and agencies and history and things like that can do the job. And the job's becoming more urgent all the time. So I think, you know, a little bit of practice what you preach at home, protect our agencies that are doing necessary jobs here. Regulation's not a dirty word, okay? Regulation's a fact of life in nature. It's a fact of life for the 7.4 billion people who depend upon her, okay? We have to regulate ourselves. And we have to help other countries either work cooperatively or individually regulate their resources. And, you know, this is just self-interest. This is not about being pretty, you know. This is about being, you know, functional or... You know,
there's a company
major unrest.
There's a company called Memphis Meats that's developing synthetic meat out of stem cells. He's a cardiologist that used to do stem cells for heart tissues, and now he's making, well, I guess it's still experimental burger patties. I don't know how they taste yet, but in the long run, that could be a solution.
Yeah, well, with A1 sauce, all is possible.
Well, one costs $330,000.
Oh,
it doesn't have any fat in it, so it's kind of...
Well, like a Tesla, it will eventually come down.
Yes.
Yeah. I'm looking forward to it. Well, thank you for a great conversation. I was just going to ask you about the cryozoos and the de-extinction process going on right now. They did bring back a guar for four minutes. So if they could succeed in that de-extinction, which they are working on pretty heavily, and I'm, as a scientist, looking forward to the science of it and everything, but what kind of regulations do you think people should be putting in place to make sure that we don't debalance the things further while trying to do good? Because now in Cincinnati Zoo, I think, and in San Diego Zoo, there's really well-established cryozoos going on.
Yeah, there's a lot of thought about what are we going to do about things that get below the numbers that they could actually come back naturally in the wild, okay? And you have to worry about genetic diversity of what's left and things like that. So I think anytime something's going to be reintroduced into the wild, we're going to have some thought about it and ask, well, what, you know, what's around? What, how's that going to influence other creatures or the habitat?
T-Rex.
Yeah.
Well, apex predator.
But sometimes you just get to do the experiment to find out.
Yeah.
But But honestly, I think that there that what's the impact that's going to come out of that effort is probably going to be small in comparison to things like invasive species that are being carted around the world all the time now. And again, this is just a fact of life, okay? It's happening, you know, a new aphid pops up in the Midwest, you know, there's, whether it's, or it's something horrible that you get to see on the evening news. There's, you know, whether it's a famous invasive or a not so famous invasive, that kind of stuff is happening. And then there's just this issue of the productivity of the habitats and ecosystems that we do have. Those, I think, are going to be the big issues to pay attention to. So I'm highly supportive from sort of a scientific point of view. You know, I'm pro woolly mammoth. I'm like, that should be the moonshot, right? I want to see a mammoth. And I think we're a rich society. We can afford those kinds of experiments and see whether or not we can pull it off. And we'll learn a lot in trying. Okay, so that's my attitude towards it. I don't think it's going to be the management tool to deal with, you know, the threat of extinction on a massive scale. I think we're going to have to do really sort of common sense, large scale sort of things, to make sure that we kind of get through the next decades without, you know, in really intense crises. So I'm all in favor sort of, but I think it's going to be more of a, I don't mean to, this sounds demeaning, I mean it's going to be a small impact, because the large impacts are going to be, you know, the things that exist in big numbers in big habitats that we all like to eat. That's where we're going to have to pay attention.
Right here.
My question, I'm listening to the interconnectedness of everything you're talking about, from the microscopic to the macroscopic. How do you see CRISPR-Cas9 and things like gene drive being used to, like, you know, make dangerous mosquitoes less dangerous and, you know, tackling invasive species? Where do you see that affecting that interconnectedness?
Yeah. So the question raises, you know, we have some new tools to think about dealing with some things that are plaguing us. I mean, you know, for example, the mosquito-carrying Zika virus right now is actually an invasive. It came from Africa very recently. And the possibility that we could devise something that would be ecologically neutral, that would take that mosquito out. So, of course, people are thinking about those sorts of things. There are other invasive plants, other invasive animals that, you know, they've been so successful as invasives because there hasn't been something there to control them, that if we can devise some kind of genetic strategy that will essentially mow them down, it's interesting to think about. Now, you're all thinking, let me see, where have I heard this before, right?
Yeah.
Right? I've seen the movies, you know, cane toads and everything else that of experiments gone awry. So, you know, we're a little wiser in 2016 that, you know, we're not omnipotent, but we are wiser, and I think we can anticipate some of these effects a little bit better. So I think that, you know, you're going to probably have to do some small scale releases to test any kind of technology or any particular intervention and see whether or not it's going to work. And for those people who may be uncomfortable because sort of, you know, well, wait, are we in the unknown realm? I'll give you an example. This is something that upsets me personally is what the cane toad has done to the eastern half of Australia. And I saw that with my own eyes in a place that I like to go to frequently in the Northern Territory of Australia, when eventually the cane toads crossed the boundary into the tropical north of the Northern Territory. It's horrible. I mean, it's a real ecological meltdown. And you sort of think, well, let me see. If we do nothing, we started this nightmare. If we do nothing, we can pretty much predict it's not going to get better. So do we do something? Do we devise something that would selectively take out the cane toads at the risk that maybe that might get out of our hands and something else, you know, might happen? So we're going to unfortunately be making this decision a lot. You know, do we go after, you know, Aedes aegypti in Brazil to try to, or now more and more South and Central America, to try to take out Zika or anything else that it's carrying, chikungunya, dengue, etc. And what risks, you know, what risks are we willing to take for what benefits? So we're going to be making these decisions a lot. But I think CRISPR-Cas9, we now have tools. We, you know, there are clever people out there thinking of ways to really annihilate, you know, individual populations. And you can tell probably from my tone, it's worth looking into. I wouldn't say stop, But I think we're going to, you know, that's going to have to require ecologists and others to be around, to be part of the discussion to figure out what the possible outcomes may be.
That's like when people talk about the bioethics concerns about genetic engineering, people are going to make Aryan children or something. It's like, let's just solve Alzheimer's. Just work on one little problem Nazis later.
Sickle cell and cystic fibrosis and Huntington's.
Yeah,
let's do that. Look, there's enough evil before you even get the genetics in the world, right? So, I mean, you know, just because you might have yet an even more, you know, evil weapon, I think we are our film industry has kind of gotten us a little bit too paranoid about things like that.
Our friend Nancy Siegel here from Twin Studies, Cal State Fullerton.
Not really a question, but a comment. My understanding is that gene editing has been done on the Zika on a fairly small scale in Brazil. They've introduced something to prevent reproduction. So I think that's something worth watching.
Yeah, I think there's releases taking place. And I think we're off Key West, are we thinking in the southern Florida? We're also thinking about whether or not to do a release to try to control those maybe dengue-carrying mosquitoes.
Definitely. Yeah. It's been going on in Brazil, and maybe Puerto Rico is the next location.
Bill, do you know something about that? You were just raising your hand. Did you?
Oh, I was hoping to get the next question, but I know they are trying to get dengue fever with mosquitoes, and I don't know if it's as far south as Key West. I think it's more central Florida. They're all for it. You know, they're terrified. I was just there this week.
Right. So. When it gets scary enough, we're willing to take some chances.
But you have a question.
I do have a question. Change the subject to politics. No, seriously. So I'm so old that I watch Meet the Press. That's, I love it. A bunch of people talking. No, what's the role of Common Core? How do you feel about Common Core? They said that's going to be the campaign issue.
What? Yeah, no kidding. All right, so how do I feel about Common Core? So a whole bunch of states get together voluntarily and decide, you know, rather than 50 of us reinventing the wheel 50 times over, maybe we can find some things that we would do in common, which we can then share curricula and we can share innovations and things like that. And somehow, that somehow has been perceived into some big government initiative. When really, that's not the momentum behind it whatsoever. So the idea that is this something that the feds are imposing upon the states, as opposed to something that a couple dozen states would like to do, to, you know, educate according to best practices, you know, in the crucial years.
When we have a follow up.
Yeah. Oh, absolutely.
Is that fight against Common Core tied to evolution?
Maybe that's an ingredient. Maybe the idea that if there's a Trojan horse, if there's this, you know, approved general curriculum, then you're going to be putting evolution and climate change and all those, you know, terrible things in there. I think there's an ingredient in that. I think there also just seems to be this ingredient that, you know, big government cannot do anything competently, so we'll reject it. And, you know, the cliche I hear is that, you know, education should be controlled at the local level. Right. That's. I mean, I've seen that in the debates. Education should be controlled at the local level, and everyone sort of nods in some, you know, way. No, I don't nod, but they. And the idea is, of course, education is in fact controlled somewhat at the local level, but the curriculum need not be designed at the local level, and that you never hear that as the follow-up question by the moderator, which is, are you really talking about, you know, it's not like we're stripping control away from school boards and school superintendents or things like that. It's about finding a curriculum that can be designed and adopted.
Did you get sucked into this thing, though? Have they consulted? They?
Well, through my role, certainly things like next generation science standards is in play and things like that, but I don't get sucked into the political side of it. Bill, here's my view. You know, I think the problem is with the view of sort of states versus Fed is that, you know, they're going to be enlightened states that are going to pull away from unenlightened states in education, in technology, and, you know, in high-tech jobs and all sorts of things. You obviously live in one, and so, you know, the evolutionary effect of that is going to be there's going to be the progressive know something states and the regressive no less not contributing, at least in a certain.
So you think this is in the future?
My crystal ball says that future is just right about there. Yeah. No, we've been there for a while, but it looks like, you know, the inclination to collaborate on matters of education is, you know, is a state-by-state sort of thing, and it won't surprise you which states want to collaborate and which states have pulled back from that. Now, what's, you know, ironic to me, and I, you know, I'm not. This is just Sean. This is not, you know, some policy statement of the Howard Hughes Medical Institute. But I look around at states like Kansas and Louisiana that are having major crises in their educational systems right now. Louisiana unable to fund mm-hmm. its higher ed system. Kansas having to, you know, having major problems with its K through 12 schools. You know, and I know what's happened in my home state of Wisconsin to the support for the educational system. So these, you know, if we think there's a relationship between even state support for education and the prosperity of that society, this should really worry people. And so I think on those debate stages, we should be talking about what's going on in particular states and what that means for the future of the citizens of those states.
So Texas Instruments has advertised in Maryland to get Maryland, University of Maryland students to go to Texas to work.
Because they can't get Texas.
Makes sense.
There you go.
Yeah.
Billboard.
And I think certainly the knowledge economy jobs, those CEOs, those HR people know where they can get graduates that are qualified or at least can be trained into the positions that they want. And there's going to be places that are going to produce those graduates and other places that are going to be way behind. And they may be way behind due to self-inflicted ideological wounds. I think that's what's going to happen. I wish it wasn't true, and I know you wish it wasn't true. But I think it's just the case that if 50 states insist on paddling their own canoes, there are a couple dozen that are going to work together, and they're going to be probably the backbone of the knowledge economy, and there are a couple of dozen that are going to be left out.
Yes?
The U.S. core curriculum is terrifying enough, but what about a global core curriculum on science? Is there any initiatives to try to kind of get science to be better understood? I mean, I'm not talking about Europe. I'm looking at these countries where actually, if anything, we are seeing, you know, an opposition to science, which is developing. And so are there things developing to help at least get people?
The things I know about on a little scale, I think they're best to be homegrown efforts, because anything else looks like imperialism, right? Let us tell you how science should be done. I think in places like Turkey, there's a lot of grassroots efforts, because that's sort of a battleground between certain ideologies and Western science. And there are people in Turkey, and you probably know folks who are pushing, you know, to keep Turkey modern. I think Iran is going to go through this some more. I think my own view from meeting various Iranians in the last few years, especially with the new, I think that's going to be one of the most interesting countries in the Middle East for the next 10, 15, 20 years in terms of how that plays out. I think there.
Yeah, the teaching of evolution in Turkey has been an issue
for
a while.
And I don't think we should be, you know, as much as evolution is near and dear to my heart, I think it's a question of, you know, how much room is there for a scientific worldview? That's a good canary in the coal mine. But and as opposed to, for example, I mean, you know, completely Dark Ages, you know, mentality. And those cultural battles are going to be fought. I think from the outside, I think U.S. society, for example, U.S. scientific societies and European scientific societies are usually always willing to provide expertise, support, any sort of form, come, you know, delegations, et cetera, to help countries who want to go, or any group in a country that wants to go down that road. But it's not a government-to-government sort of relationship. I think it's a more NGO-to-NGO relationship in those countries.
The common knowledge through mass media, for example, is one way to diffuse the knowledge. That's just so common, you don't have to say that what that should be taught. Everybody
right.
knows it.
Everybody knows it if they have access to it.
Let's see, Mark right. in the back, I think you had a question from Annie Mohai, one of our
speakers here. I was wondering if you could comment a little bit on the relationship between genetic predisposition and environmental factors. Some have called this a mismatch between the environment we live in now, carcinogens, increase in asthma, Alzheimer's, et cetera, and hominid evolution for millions of years. And some have taken it down to the level of gut microbes, right, and how that affects humanity. Because it seems like some of the cancer drugs were like chasing the tail. We're creating carcinogens and then trying to develop pharmaceuticals to cure.
Yeah, well, I think you your question also included a whole lot of background right there for everybody to kind of get on the same page. Mm-hmm. I don't think I'm any extra qualified to address that. You know, there is an appreciation that our cultural evolution has moved very, very, very quickly relative to our biological evolution. That's just a fact of how quickly can our gene pool change. And of course, natural selection has been suspended to a degree in humanity because we have all these institutions that protect us from disease and nourish us long into life. Obviously, the invention of medicine and also sanitation and all this sort of thing. We do experience pandemics and things like that. But we are living essentially with weaker natural selection as a species. There we go. Now, we are biologically, biochemically, not significantly different from humans 20,000 years ago. That's a little bit of an overstatement, like our ability to digest milk.
Yes.
That's a big upside. It happened twice. That evolution's happened twice in humanity, so in pastoral societies, and that's fairly recent. There's a little bit that's gone on with us physiologically, but as we spread about the globe and living in all sorts of different habitats, there's some evolution that's going on there in terms of body physiology and all that. But as a species, not so much. Where does that leave us? That leaves us, as you're saying, our access to calories has changed, radically in the last 100 years, and perhaps even more radically in the last 50 years, right? Cheap, large amounts of calories. Our bodies like calories. I'm thinking about it right now. So, without a little self-regulation, we can get ourselves into not such good health. But I think it's just, you said about genetic disposition. So genetically, we're in some ways a little bit different than we were 5, 10, 20,000 years ago. Environmentally, we're radically different than we were 5, 10, or 20,000 years ago. And yes, you're right. I think this idea of mismatch has a lot of credibility, that we live in an environment with various irritants, pollutants, other sorts of agents, hormone mimics and things like this. May be playing games with our biology.
Do you worry about GMOs?
That's, God, you guys love...
The big one.
GMO,
the big
question. Yeah, these are the questions you ask when you come up here to Altadena. Why do we die and what do you think of GMOs? It's a case-by-case basis. Yeah. It's a combination, again, of good science and good management. So GMOs, are they all bad? No.
Right.
They're going to be a necessary part of life for feeding the planet. Are GMOs ecologically a problem? In case by case, yes, they are.
What they do to the environment?
Well, or the way we manage GMO crops, what that does to the environment.
Okay,
plant itself may be pretty innocent, but not the way we manage that field is not innocent. Herbicides and fertilizers,
right,
et cetera. And fertilizers are especially, having a big impact on freshwater systems that and on estuaries and coastal systems, tremendous effects that again, we're living, why would we, don't get me started for a second. I'll stay on the GMOs. So GMOs, again, I'm always going to back into this, which is, it's a combination of good science and good management. And if you're lacking either one, you're in trouble, right? So science alone without good management, how are you going to manage without knowing the science in the first place? But the problem is often as these things erupt into our culture, our attitude about GMOs is, it's a little heightened anxiety in the States, but in Europe, my goodness,
yes,
right? It's a totally different climate. And that, the spillover effect of that in Africa, which is, absolutely going to be dependent upon genetically modified crops, they have to get productivity per acre up. If it's not good enough for the Europeans, they're not going to eat it. So they're not going to plant it. Uh-oh. So the dialogue where, which I might argue is more philosophical, or let's just call it philosophical than scientific, the spillover effect of that can be huge in terms of, managing the food supply for big swaths of the world. So we got to be careful when we, you know, when we engage on these particular issues, because they do have consequences. You know, whether or not Whole Foods labels their bananas, okay, it's not going to affect humanity, okay? But if the debate over here gets to the point where, you know, there's an issue that, you know, Chipotle is not going to have GMO crops in its food and General Mills and all this kind of stuff, well, then Africa and Asia aren't going to use those either. And, you know, you certainly have the recipe for famine, you know, set up in both places. So we got to be a little careful about this dialogue.
Bill, you had a change of heart on this, didn't you, a little
Absolutely.
Bit? What's your position on GMOs?
Case by case.
Case by case, okay. No, right.
But also, if you like numbers, we can now ask, because there's so much money in it, we can now assay genomes about 10 to the 7th, 10 million times faster than we could 10 years ago. So you really can evaluate how a plant interacts with predators. They have whole, you know, insectaries, whether they, you know, try to get corn plants eaten by corn borers or whatever it is. My concern always was the ecosystem. You don't know, is some butterfly going to be affected, and the bats that eat the butterfly, or now and then the mosquito population is going to go up. But actually, you can know the effect, at least on predator prey, very well. The thing that's not being done right is so-called monoculture. And the best explanation, I'm not changing the subject, the best explanation right now for colony collapse disorder in bees is lack of genetic diversity. We've accidentally inbred the bees too much. And then you release them or you present them like they're like itinerant workers. You present them with this huge cornfield. It's all the same plant, all comes blossoms at the same time. And then you move them to another field. It may be that they're too inbred and we don't manage the farms properly. But man, this business of, they have it now, the man, has it now, where they tell the soil chemistry within a few centimeters using global positioning systems. And the plan is to plant the crop, the specific plant in each, you know, within a 10 centimeter distance, that are depending on how much water falls there. Like if it's on the slightly up slope, it gets a more drought tolerant plant than the one at the bottom land that gets more water. Like the guys, say what you will, but they are thinking about feeding 10 billion people.
They did Monsanto, right?
Monsanto and Pioneer, DuPont.
Oh, DuPont.
And the companies in China that are using the same engineering. but the machines that assay genes are just crazy. They're so fast now.
And it's not just it's the farmers, right, who've made a living like this and upon whom we are dependent, right?
Yeah.
So, you know, what tools are they being given? I want to just mention a story. Bill's discussion reminds me of something out of Asia, and this has to do with rice crops, and I tell the story in the book. This was an eye-opener to me. So, you know, in the 1960s, there was concern that there could be widespread famine in Asia because there just was not enough food. And this was really part of what's prompted the Green Revolution and the founding of new institutes and the new strains of rice and then, you know, more systematic Golden practice rice. Of fertilization and things like this. And, you know, productivity is going up. And then there's a new problem that pops up, something called hopper burn. And hopper burn is when these little plant hoppers sort of infest a field and really sort of suck all the juices out of the plant, and it just has this burn. This is an insect, a little plant hopper. Yep. And so when you see these hoppers in the field, the farmer's first instinct, of course, is nuke them with pesticides, right? So walk through the field, spray the pesticide on them. I'm doing this for a couple of years, but really by the early, mid-1970s, what starts popping up is they're sprayed with pesticide and the insect counts go up 100-fold. Uh-oh. What's going on? Now, what was finally understood, was that pesticide, the bugs had evolved resistance to the pesticide, so they were like, whatever. But why did their numbers go up? Because the pesticide was killing off their natural enemies in the fields, spiders and other insects that eat them.
Right.
So, for example, Indonesia then trained more than 1 million farmers in integrated pest management to teach them, for example, to plant some other plants around the rice that would be natural refuges for natural enemies of the hoppers, to be more prudent in the application of pesticide. And sometimes the best thing to do is not to spray, and you could show that in field trials. Yes, the bugs are there, they're always there. Don't spray.
And see what happens.
See what happens in their control. So, but there's a lot of pressure, and there's a lot of, you know, you can imagine just sort of the instinct. I see these bugs, I'm worried that my field could get ruined, so of course I'm gonna spray.
Right.
And you do have companies and new companies on the scene really encouraging the use of pesticides.
Right.
But they're essentially, you would say medically, they're contraindicated for these fields. What we need is we need better biocontrol, including natural control methods. And you know, pesticides at times as an adjunct, but not as the star, you know, the star control agent, because we've already learned that that's not the way it works. But the spider thing, I just bring that up because, again, we don't think about these predators, and this is the Serengeti Rules sort of thing, which is, you know, whether it's spiders or wolves or sharks or lions, they're all playing these roles in these ecosystems, controlling some of the things that are downstream, the things downstream that we don't want to see large numbers of.
Right.
And then we step in and we think we want to control those downstream things, and we screw it up. So there's certainly the practice of planting now other things around around you know, GMO crops to increase the diversity of plant habitat that's immediately around, increase the biodiversity of natural enemies that are in the area. These are practices now being learned, now that we've seen some things go awry.
You have it.
I have a comment that I think maybe relates to your starfish. Recently on the coast of British Columbia, where they have huge amounts of raccoons who are going to the ocean edge and eating fish and doing this. And so they set up sound barriers in different areas with dogs barking because raccoons become afraid of dogs barking. So they set it up, and then they've been measuring what the effects are. And the raccoons are very necessary, they discovered. And I think that relates to the same kind of research that was done with the starfish as far as when is it a predator and when is it a good thing?
Yeah, well.
Or it is,
yeah,
when
I mean,
is a predator
for us,
a good thing?
When a predator is a good thing. I mean, the bears that take the salmon, there's no kind of delicate way to put this, but when bears process salmon on the banks of rivers, it's a good thing for the forest.
Yeah.
Yes.
Fertilizer.
So when asked, does a bear in the woods?
Yes, it
the
does.
Answer is you hope so. Yeah. So, you know,
that's great.
Again, the marvelous things that ecologists find out. Yeah.
Okay, that was a comment. Now I have a question.
Oh, it's a twofer. Okay.
He's probably no part of that question already. You have gone from being a strict scientific writer, journal publications, research, to where you have become a storyteller. And you always seem to tell stories that have something to do with science. But when you wrote about Jacques Monod and Albert Camus, that was the most wonderful story that I think anyone could have ever told. How did you come to make the decisions that you wanted to go into storytelling rather than just writing journal articles?
The money.
That's a great question. No, it's not the money per hour. I think all the authors in the room can tell you that. Thank you for that comment. So the honest, and I'll give you hopefully what's an honest answer, if I can be honest with myself. I had teachers that told stories. And I found, and this is for the students that are in the room, and maybe I'll get some nods back there, which is, for some reason, it was always refreshing to me when a prof kind of certainly went off program and started telling a story. We like stories. We crave stories. Hopefully, some of you showed up today because you're hoping to get a story, something that you could take back home. This is why we go to the movies. This is why we watch television, right? This is why we hang out with each other in a bar. We're a storytelling creature. And I found, so I had these teachers that I remembered them. I remembered them, the storytellers. And I found somehow in class at Wisconsin, when I would go off the rails and start telling a story, I could tell students appreciate it. And sometimes I'd meet them, you know, a couple years later after they graduated, you know, downtown, something like that. And they're like, you know, Dr. Carroll, I still remember that story you told about so-and-so. And I thought.
But they don't remember your PowerPoint slide.
Yeah, exactly. That was an artfully done graph, Dr. Carroll, yeah. So I wish somebody told me this sooner. And I just try to tell everybody this now, especially when I'm on campuses, which is I wish somebody told me at 25, it's all about the storytelling. And it turns out it doesn't matter. It's true with journal articles. It's true with formal scientific presentations. It's true in every form. If you make the effort to try to become a better storyteller, you know, it elevates the quality of what you're doing. Also, for me, it increases the fun. But I think the desire to be a better storyteller started as an educator, and I especially felt challenged that way when people were asking me about my own field. Come talk to us about Evo Devo and what that is. And say, well, my, you know, what am I going to do? You know, here's the genes. Oh my God! You know, we're dead. it just has evolved into more and more. And when I say storytelling, you know, it has a bad connotation in a scientific audience. It's like, oh, that means, you know, it doesn't mean being any less accurate, et cetera. But it means thinking about, for example, the scientist as a character with motivations, with other people in their lives. And, you know, some of the people that Michael's written about, I mean, he wrote this great book about Alfred Wallace. Is there a better story of a scientific pioneer going out across the world and encountering nature and trying to figure out what it means? Because that's a lot of what, certainly in my world of biology, people did, was they went out into the world and realized the world was, you know, they
interesting.
It was interesting and mysterious, and they were trying to figure out those sorts of mysteries. So I try to put the reader or the audience in the shoes of scientists, and if I can, in the souls of scientists. Why are they motivated to do this? What are they encountering? I think especially people like Wallace and Darwin, who left their loved ones behind for years, not knowing if they would even survive and mm-hmm. come back. You think, what does that take? You know, these were, to me, these were the first astronauts, right?
Wallace's brother went to South America to visit him and died.
And died, yeah.
We got time for two more questions.
Is to put the human in the story, and this, you know, science, you could think science, but really, you know, science is done by people. Yeah, so
we'll do you and Simbad. Go ahead, Simbad.
I wanted to ask, so do you think intelligence or artificial intelligence is the end of the line or end result of evolution? You see what I mean?
Oh boy, AI in the future. Another big question.
Heavy stuff. It's Sunday afternoon,
I
folks,
know.
Really.
The wine
you know,
is
in
coming.
In Wisconsin, we just have beer and watch football reruns, you know?
So are we the end of the line of evolution?
Yeah. It's a really great, there's probably, I'm too biased that the biosphere is too important, too complex, too magnificent, to become sort of just a spectator, you know, to AI. So when you say in terms of our evolution, is AI it, and essentially are we leaving the bounds of biological evolution? You want to put it that way?
Sure. Another way to ask the question would be, do all species evolve into intelligence? Like, is that the end?
No. Not by what we would say is intelligence, no. And they're doing just fine.
Yeah. You don't have to be smart.
You know, 4,000 species of fruit flies just rocking the fruit fly. Okay? So yeah, there's no direction to evolution. It's the spaces that are available. You know, if you go... I mean, sort of like the simplest thing in my mind. You go to a Caribbean island, go to Puerto Rico, go to Haiti, something like this, and go to the trees, and there's anole lizards that live sort of at different floors in the canopy, and their body types have evolved, characteristic shapes and things like that, depending upon where they live, and this has happened independently in those different forests. There's just nothing going on there that says, you know, I'm aspiring to the top of the tree. It's like, I'm happy right here, eating the bugs that live right here. You stay up there, you stay down there. I'll head bob my mates, you'll head bob your mates. I'll signal this color, et cetera. No, the biosphere is just filling the space that's available, and there's no direction. And you know, you could kind of argue that if we wind up destroying ourselves, is that really kind of like the pinnacle of intelligence? You know,
that's a good point, you know, yep. Last question.
Could you discuss your thoughts about our need for oil and gas and balancing that with ecology?
Yeah, you know, I think others would also say, you know, I think we're in a transitional phase, you know, between fossil fuels. The supply has been extended because of engineering feats in shale and things like that. That years ago when we were having this discussion, we thought we were hitting peak oil. Wrong, because we can still extract stuff, and at $100 a barrel, it's economic. At $30 a barrel, it's bankrupt. Mm-hmm. So we're in a transitional phase, because as I understand it from energy experts, and you've probably talked more than I have, you know, the percentage of our energy that we're getting from renewables keeps creeping up. But that transition, you know, I'm sure everybody's frustrated that the transition's slow. But you know, I think natural gas and oil are here for some period of time, and they have to be here because we can't. It would be a rough day in Wisconsin, I can tell you, without that natural gas or oil. But I think we're in a multi-decade transition, and the question is, you know, everyone's wondering is are we going to end up pumping out so much more carbon dioxide that you know the after effect is going to last even longer, and of course being of greater magnitude. So that's the pickle we're in at the moment of having so much of human activity being driven by fossil fuels that we can't wean ourselves off it too quickly. But at the same time, you can see renewables creeping in. You can see innovation having an impact. I saw a talk by Stephen Chu, the former Secretary of Energy. You know, if you look at the curves, it doesn't look too bad. I see some nodding in the room. I mean, mm-hmm. I don't know what the level of damage is going to be by that point, but. You're not going to see changes overnight, but you're going to see changes within a generation that I think are going to be pretty profound.
Well, that takes care of that for today. If you want to thank our speakers, please take that, Sean. You can get your book signed up here. You can get wine and food back there.